So, in fact, let me talk about shuffling real quick. So the thing is, what you normally do is, for example, you have two different experiments in one or two different conditions in one, and then you want to shuffle them, but you also want to make sure that it's not the case that, for example, in the entire first half of the experiment you're showing condition one, and the entire second half you show condition two. So either this, or for example, you also don't even want condition one, condition one, condition one, condition two, condition two, condition two. So you don't want one condition to appear in a row more than one or two times. So you may not want to have more than one trial of the same condition behind each other, and you also don't want the first experiment to be present only in the first half, such that, for example, if you have three different ones or two experiments and one set of distractors, you only have the distractors in the second one, in the second half of the experiment. Okay, so let's do some code to generate what I showed you, what I wanted to explain here. So we generate three lists of a certain number of elements. So we now have, if we do this for 10 elements of each list, we simply create A1, A2, A3, and so on until A10. The same for B and the same for C. So imagine these are 10 trials for conditions A, 10 trials for condition B, and 10 trials for condition C. Okay, and now we don't want them after the other, but we want to shuffle them. So normally we would use random.shuffle, but we want to have the constraint or the condition that it holds that for every two elements that follow each other, they're not supposed to be of the same type. So this condition returns false if, for example, two C's are in a row. Okay? And for the entire thing, this basically is the condition if they are ever inside this shuffled list, two C's in a row. And now we want to shuffle, but we also want to follow this condition. We want this condition to be true. The easiest approach to do so is just to test the conditions we want in a function, like I did here, and then shuffle until this condition is met. But this has a theoretical runtime of O infinity. So these theoretical runtimes you may remember from Computer Science A or Algorithmen und Datenstrukturen, and having O of infinity is really, really bad. So this way may run infinitely long because you may always, every single time that you shuffle, you may shuffle to a way where this condition is not met. For example, there's a C1 after a C2. So this is not good. And the more restrictions you have, and the more items you have in your list, so the more, well, trials you have, the less likely the shuffle, well, that any correct shuffle will ever be found. So this here is the easy way. And here we want to generate again 10 trials for each of the conditions. And what we're doing is here, we're shuffling until the condition is met. You're seeing this took quite some time. And if we would generate, I don't know, 30. Spelling error. But if we generate 30 each, as we see here, this will run quite some time. So we don't want to do this. What we could instead do, for example, is go for divide and conquer, provided the problem we have can easily be divided. Okay? So what we're doing here is that when we generate the lists here, we are already generating shuffled versions of the respective lists, such that A, B, and C are already in a shuffled order. And then we are boiling down, we are dividing our problem, so our list of 30 elements, into chunks of 5 each. And then we're only doing our shuffling until we find a correct solution for every of these chunks. So we are creating a temporary list which contains only, in this case, 5 elements of each of the lists of A, B, and C, which are already in a shuffled order, so it's okay to take them. And then only for this list of now 15 with 5 different, with 5 of each condition each, elements, we are doing the shuffling until we find a correct solution. And then once we did so, which should be rather quick for such a short list, we append that to our TMP lists here. And then we only have to make sure that if our condition was that no A should follow after another A, we have to make sure that if we are making one list out of the sublists here, that it's not the case that, well, one of the subproblems ended with the condition A and the one after that starts with condition A. So if that should be the case for any of these lists, what we're simply doing is that we are putting the first element to the back of the respective list, such that if it used to start with an A, now it starts with anything but A, because we know there are never two A's in a row. And then we are simply making one flattened list from this list of lists. And if we do this and run this, we see it runs really quickly in comparison to what we did here. And our condition is met. So we have C, A, B, C, B, A, B, C, A, C, B, A, B, C, A, etc., etc., but never two A's or B's or C's in a row. Divide and conquer. The second possibility is to simply drop the idea of shuffling until you find one and build the desired sequence one at a time, such that, well, you start with a zero element list, you add an element, for example, A, and then when you want to add the next element, you look at the last one you added and check if that was also A. So we have this list of allowed here, which is for the first element true for each of the conditions. So we again use our generateList2 function, which shuffles already the sublists and returns all 3 sublists. And then what we're doing is we are keeping note which of these lists we can take from next, and if so, what the index is. So we start at the first element of all 3 lists, and then we decide using this here if we want to take from one of the lists. So we can only select from the ones for which this list allowed is true. And then we simply append the next element using our indices here of that list to our merged list. Okay? And then we are resetting this list allowed here, and are setting only, so if we added an A, now as next element we're not allowed to set an A anymore, but B and C would be true, which is what we're doing here. And then once we went through all of them here, so if we have an index error, we're simply passing, so if we're already done with one of the lists, so B, and then we're simply passing, such that now we select C. I think this is also O of infinity now that I think of it, because we could, so if we only have the choice between B and C and we already are at the end of list B, this could in theory always try to select from B, get an index error, pass, try to get B, get an index error, pass, but well, this is a 50-50 chance, so we'll probably do so only once or zero times. And if everything is done here, so once the list we created is as long as all the sublists here added, we're done and we can print merged. And this again leads to a result where we never have two A's or B's or C's in a row. And it's just another way. I'm not sure which one is quicker. Probably this one, because this one never needs to do the shuffling until a condition is met. So probably this here is the one you may want to use. And if you want to look at how experiment shuffles, it shows so in the documentation here. So it can also do this randomization within small mini blocks. All right, that's it.